Hello, I am Chauncey DeVega. You may recognize my voice from Ring of Fire Radio with Mike Papantonio, the BBC, Sirius XM, or the Tom Hartman Radio Show. And you may have read some of my essays at places like Salon and Alternate. I would like to thank all of you for listening to, downloading, tweeting, and sharing the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show.
And they ran a story by somebody named Chauncey DeVega.
Quote, I find black garbage pail kids, black conservatives, fascinating.
That's just unbelievable. You know, it's...
He goes by the name of Chauncey DeVega.
You know, I've been called Uncle Tom, Oreo, sellout, shameless. But this is a new one.
Well, let's talk now to Chauncey DeVega.
As my man Chauncey DeVega of the blog We Are Respectable Negroes says,
I have author and blogger Chauncey DeVega here with us.
Hello, and welcome to the eponymous podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. Good show. You hear my voice. I'm still recovering. Friends of ChaunceyDeVega.com, Indomitable, have been following my epic struggle and journey in my battle to recover from food poisoning. As I said, I got a good guest. See, a professional. This is quoting the great professional wrestler Jake the Snake Roberts, who has apparently very good documentary out about his life. It's supposed to be excellent. Said a professional is someone who even on their worst day can perform at a high level and better than everybody else. So you are getting me. Let me count here. Friday night was the incident, the consumption of poison at a certain fast food restaurant in downtown Chicago run by a religious sect that closes on the weekend and got in trouble for not liking gay people. I'll leave it at that. A befouled chicken sandwich. That was the only thing I ate, too. Made me sick. And I'll get you the details about that shortly. But as I said, a professional follows through. So I'm still recovering from that. I don't know how pregnant ladies deal with it. This nausea thing. I have much recovered. I can eat. I can drink. Let me tell you. Chauncey DeVega was so out of it. If Rosario Dawson had showed up and wanted to go on Space Mountain, I would have had to put out of order an out of order sign right on the door. And again, my own personal hell continues in my turned over Jawa Sandcrawler. Folks who listened to the podcast episode with M. Lamar gave him a little treat. He and I chatted, and then I think it was the following episode. I'm just discombobulated. I told you about the amorous ruttings of my neighbors. And I swear I come home, and all a brother wants to do is do his intro and outro for the epic and awesome podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. And I am accompanied by the serenades of love. And it's always the same damn noises. So I don't know what the hell's going on. But this episode, we got the one and only, as I said, sometimes you score a coup. He's really nice, super smart. And you know, when you talk to real masters of their craft, there's very little arrogance. It can go either way. It can be like super hubris because they can back it up. I imagine Tom Brady is that way. He's like, yeah, I'm the best quarterback on earth and I'm the best team and we're awesome. And he'd let you know it because he can talk the talk and walk the walk. And there are other people who are just cool. And our guest this episode, sociologist, give you all his credentials later, and many, many articles and books, Douglas McAdam, Stanford University. He and I, we chatted about Black Lives Matter, social movements, the Tea Party, religious polarization. And as I said, going back to my metaphor, the analogy of the Cadillac car, man, he let me drive the Cadillac car, and he was a great guest and the co-driver as he explained the music, how the car ran, what radio stations we should listen to, and the route we should take. So it was a great, great, great conversation. But I got waylaid. As I said, I'm still... Oh, wait a minute. Now, I have an excuse now. An excuse for my high fructose corn syrup. You hear the can? That's the can. Schweppes ginger ale to help with my waves of nausea. Let me take a sip because I may have a flashback because I'm afraid to go on public transportation for fear of vomiting and pooping myself. I've got PTSD. Hold on. I'll leave that little belch in there. It's so good. And my neighbors right now, they're doing the foreplay, which I think involves tickling. Tickling, folks. Whatever you get your freak on. I think they toe suckers. I think he's sucking on him toes and tickling her. Get your freak on, folks. Get your freak on. So Douglas McAdam was super cool. And where else can you have a podcast where you got one of the country's leading sociologists, experts on social movements, American politics, a story about your intrepid hosts being waylaid by voodoo demons. I think it was a hex. I think Fox News and Ben Carson got together and they said, we're going to put some mojo on that Negro. Too much truth telling. Causing us trouble. Man, they knocked me the hell out, but I'm still here. So, giving you that update. Got on the bus. Friday night, I was happy. I told you. And so many things going on in the world. Let me tell you, we got the Star Wars trailer, of course. We'll talk about that. My man Bill the Lizard is going to be joining us next week. And we also have a great guest who's the author of a book called Star Wars FAQ. So we're going to have a Star Wars themed episode next week. So I'll give you some quick thoughts on that Star Wars too. That Rush card. Got to talk about that because I was telling you, as I said last week, I had to go to the check cashing place because money was burning a hole in my pocket. Got the check, broke Mama DeVega off 5 big ones. Had to do it. I ain't no Rockefeller. Had to give her a bunch of that check. Was feeling good. You know, you do the money dance, the money walk, and you're strutting like Kramer in that Seinfeld remix video where somebody did it with T.I., I think. But he walking like a boss. Had a good day. Feeling good. And I went on a walkabout. You ever go on a walkabout? Remember Babylon 5, the doctor, the late doctor, I forgot his name. He went on a walkabout. And you walk until you meet yourself, like the Aborigines suggest. So it was a Friday. I went downtown because I didn't get to do everything I wanted on Thursday. I did have a nice Thursday, though. Whew. Got downtown, went to a certain restaurant, and, you know, I had a granola bar, you know, because I got to watch the weight. I take the ginger, the ginseng, because my knee is 98%, but I put on a little weight from that exercising over the summer. Wandered, bumped into somebody I know. She escorted me on walkabout a little bit. I returned some change. See, I'm like an old man with these routines, things that make me happy. I had some change. I save up change every so many weeks, so I got 6 cups of emergency change, and I got an extra that I waste. So I said, I'm going to top off the check I got with some change. I bring the change to the supermarket, bump into somebody I know. She escorts me on the walkabout. For a little while, it gets cold. She goes back, and I continue walkabout. Where I wanted to go was, I didn't know if I wanted to eat a cheesecake. You know, I love some Cheesecake Factory. I know it's bad. I know it's horrible. I was by myself. I didn't care. I'm an only child. I can manage my own company. I didn't go to the movie because it was too long. As I said, I'm an old man who's eccentric. So I go to this place, get a chicken sandwich, fried, because I figure it's fried. That'll kill everything. Go to another spot, hang out with some people, counsel a stranger who was dealing with bad dreams and had gone on a ghostly tour of downtown Chicago. And I counseled her about her father, or rather her mother who passed away, in guilt and regret and sharing. You know, because I am a man of the people. I am a man of the people who shares and listens. I am humble in my magnanimity. That a word, magnanimity? You know, I got that grammar demon that comes back every now and then. So, go hang out at my spot, get a cab home. And I should have known something was amiss. I get home and I'm like, I feel like I may have mud butt. Thought nothing of it. I said the system needs to get cleaned out. And as I said, this is a grown folks conversation. But we're all friends at the virtual bar. So I wake up the next day, have my tea, my granola bar, get the day started, had some things to take care of. I was going to have an A-plus day, see 2 movies, maybe go to the casino, get a snack. I was thinking about the Star Wars trailer on Monday and my soon-to-be Super Bowl champs again, the New England Patriots getting their revenge on the Colts on Sunday. Boy, I was feeling good. Get on the bus. And before I got on the bus, you see, I felt a little faint. You ever feel just, I thought it was low blood sugar. I thought nothing of it. So, get on the bus. It goes 1 block. And you know when something's going wrong, you're in the state, your system is just processing what's happening. I go 2 blocks. And I'm like, something may be wrong here. 3 blocks. I'm like, yeah, no, this is not my imagination. And now you're at the point where you gotta jump off the bus stand, because now it's going to get too far away. It's about half a mile from where I live. And I see the stop before it goes a whole bunch of other blocks. And I said, dear God, I'm having a heart attack. Because somewhere in my mind, I had filed away that you have nausea when you have a heart attack. I said, oh, Jesus. Just had a birthday. Still not the man I was, but still not an old, decrepit man. I didn't fall down, broke my leg almost. Other health things. I'm like an old man talking about your problems. And I said, oh, God. And I tell, I hit that thing to get off that bus, and I start to walk. I get a 5-10 yards, and I said, oh, damn, and hide behind a bush, and I throw up. Bleh. You ever hear Beetlejuice on Howard Stern when he throws up? Bleh. That's what it sounded like. I said, damn, I'm going to die. I'm having a heart attack. So I stumble, I'm stumbling. And I said, damn, I got my new sweater shirt on, my jean looking good on my good day to be had, and I'm going to die. So I said, ooh, there's a fire department. So I stumbled some more. And I said, let me post up here against this telephone because I don't want anybody to see me throwing up. What happens again? Everything is coming out. I said, oh, no. Because now I'm not thinking rationally. I said, I got to get home. If I'm going to die, I got to get home. Because one would think if you're dying, you go to the fire department, but not me. Few more steps. Again, behind a pole in the corner. And I'm saying, man, how much stuff is in me? Long story short, I somehow managed to get a few more blocks. And I'm vomiting about twice a block at this point. Behind bushes, and I'm hiding. I sneak through the park. Again, I'm irrational. If I'm dying, I should probably be where people can see me. But I was like, no. I don't want anybody to see me thrown up all over the place. And I'm leaning up against another pole. And I double over. And God is my witness. I'm thinking I'm going to die on the street from a heart attack. This has to be a heart attack. I'm having hot flashes. I'm disoriented. And I started thinking, I'm going to miss that Patriots game. And I'm going to miss the Star Wars trailer. I'm going to die before the new Star Wars movie. I'm a truth man. I somehow managed to stumble and bumble my way home. And I'm passing people looking down on the ground. My eyes must have been red. I must have stunk. People looked at me like I was crazy. I'm navigating. I'm sneaking. And I'm saying, God, don't let me throw up in the street. Because I couldn't stop it. Get in my humble Jawa Sandcrawler / apartment turned over on its side. My turned over Jawa Sandcrawler like Rey lives in on the planet Jakku, a.k.a. Tatooine for all intents and purposes in the new Star Wars trailer. And I'm saying, okay. Now with these phones, you call 911, they may not know where you are. If you don't have that thing enabled, the location, I don't let them know where I am. So I get the bright idea. I said, I'm going to leave the door unlocked. And put the two cell phones near me in my landline in case I got to call the ambulance. They won't knock the door down. I'm telling you, folks, I said, I need a bucket. I was on my knees at the toilet. I was throwing up in buckets. I took my clothes off, laying on my raggedy futon, my lived-in rustic futon, I like to call it. It's had some life. It's had life. I'm not a materialistic person. Futon works. So I'm laying there, and you have the visual, this beautiful god of a man, waylaid like Samson when that woman took his hair, but I was worn out and waylaid by a chicken sandwich, and I'm sweating, and I had the bucket, and I said, no, I'll make it. No, I didn't make it. Then phase two began, mud butt, on the toilet, throwing up, on the toilet. The vomiting is so bad, folks, I felt like I was having a seizure. Nothing's coming out. And I'm just saying, God, just kill me. And I kept thinking about Star Wars. And I kept thinking about the Patriots game. So fast forward 24 hours later, the TV on, the door unlocked, me half awake, half asleep. I somehow mustered up the strength to get up, throw some mouthwash in my mouth. I don't smell too bad. Put some water on my face, get some more supplies, come back and lay out and sleep for several days. So my dilemma now is my stomach still ain't right, people. How long does this take for this voodoo hex to pass? Is there some recipe? Do I need to go and get something to work with this voodoo hex to get it off me? The demon is still in me. And let me tell you, ain't nothing stink worse. Because we're friends. I'm telling you the truth. Than that poison, mud, butt, toilet, doo-doo. Dear goodness, I didn't know the human body could produce such stink. So I'm getting back to normal. Had the Gatorade, I gotta stay hydrated. One more sip, hold on, of Schweppes, hold on. That settles the stomach, doesn't it? Oh, it's good for you, it heals you. Mother burp, it heals you, baby, it heals you. That's what professionals do. We endure no matter what. So Star Wars, very quickly, I said Bill Wizard's gonna be on next week, and we're gonna do a whole Star Wars episode. So I had a piece of Salon, of course, talking about the racist trolls. And I think they thought they got one over on a brother and all the other folks who caught up their BS. See the Daily Show. The Daily Show did a good one about their racism, saying the new Star Wars movie, anti-white. Well, I've written volumes about Star Wars. Anti-white is the least of their inaccurate descriptions. They have a lot more going on with these new movies than that, that's for sure. And, of course, their defenders say, oh, you overreacted. They trolled you, Chauncey. They taught me on Twitter dozens, hundreds of tweets. I just block these sewer dwellers because I'm playing that 3D chess. You see, they're illiterate and they're stupid. And they're profoundly ignorant, they're children. Because my point was, you look at that white racist backlash about foolishness, about a Star Wars movie that they claim is anti-white folk control Hollywood, control this economy. And not because they're white, it's about power, institutional power. Yet they can claim some sort of insecurity. That's classic, to quote my man Gordon Gartrell, white victimology. In this case, white male toxic victimology blues. You got all the toys and you complain about others. And you know what? And this is why I was laughing at these idiots. You can take an example and use it to talk about something that's more generalizable, which is what I did. I said, well, we got this toilet sewer dweller right-wing trolls. We've got this thing called, remember Gamergate? You've got white conservatives in general talking about being victimized. You've got men's rights activists. They're all in the same public trough urinal. So it was some good truth-telling there, my salon piece about the new Star Wars movie. I'm trying to, as I like to say, connect the dots. So a few thousand people read that. I appreciate the folks who tweeted, downloaded, and shared it. Much appreciated. Thoughts very quickly, because I don't want to give away everything, because we'll have our Star Wars episode. Star Wars Episode 7 episode next week of the podcast. Yeah. Liked the trailer. Had a geekgasm. Watched it repeatedly. A few things to look out for. Note the use of the words none and no one in the trailer. Watch that. It's basically a remake, folks, of Star Wars A New Hope. You got a desert planet, you have a quest, you have a sacred object, and that's what Lucas did. Lucas borrowed from Kurosawa and Flash Gordon, and J.J. Abrams is a very, very, very synthetic filmmaker. Hopefully Kasdan will get something original out of it. As I said, I won't give away everything, but I can't help it. So the original trilogy, the core trilogy, is about a son trying to redeem the father. Now in this one we have parents, father, uncle, we don't know, trying to redeem a lost son, nephew, and Kylo Ren. He's either Luke, Han, Leia's kid. So you got that relationship. You've got the Force Awakening, which I like. It's the idea of sort of the age of magic coming and going in Arthurian legend. That's cool. But it really is A New Hope. You have a desert planet. You have a quest. Even the beginning of the movie, folks. A New Hope, what R2 and C-3PO on Tatooine. What do we have here? Finn and Rey on Jakku. We have a Death Star. We have an ice planet like on Hoth. And we probably are even going back to Yavin 4, which is where Han Solo is hiding, / hanging out, / retired with his Mandalorian flag. Notice that Easter egg. But I think the Force is strong with this one. But then again, folks were dazzled and bewondered by the Phantom Menace trailer too. But I think we're in much better hands here with Kasdan looking over the shoulder of J.J. Abrams. So feeling good. We're going to break that whole thing down. And as I said before, repeatedly, Bill the Lizard and I have figured out this plot. I would go to Vegas. I would give them odds and say we've got about 95% of it figured out. And it could be good or bad. It could be good or bad. So, other goodies in this episode. And not an overstuffed, supersized burrito episode. That'll be next week. This is a good, healthy, fine dining. This is the 8-ounce, perfectly cooked filet mignon with a red wine reduction or a garlic compound butter. With asparagus, if you like. I don't like asparagus because my peas smell funny. A double-baked potato. Horseradish crusted, bacon-wrapped filet cooked medium. That's what this episode is. And your appetizer of choice. Bacon-wrapped scallops, maybe shrimp, maybe skewers of some sort. I don't know what you like. We got to have the double-baked potato or garlic bread. Yeah, that's this conversation. Douglas McAdam, that's what this combo is. It's a perfect meal. That's what this conversation is. See, I can get sick, food poisoning, I'm making food analogies and tell you I'm hungry. And that's when you get sick as a dog, you just don't want to eat. I guess those are our carnal desires, the flesh, the desire for life. But that Russell Simmons rush card, if you haven't been following that, last episode I talked about going to that check cashing place because I just had money burning a hole in my pocket. They refused to cash the check, by the way. So I had to wait for the 24 hours for the check to clear. And it was a wake-up call to see how folks are forced into these almost criminally exploitive in terms of interest, usurious interest rates, unreliable banking, which is why the post office needs to offer low-cost banking to poor and working-class people and others locked out of the banking system. So these poor folks got that rush card, and they couldn't get their money. Couldn't pay their bills, because his raggedy system and the vendor didn't work. It backed up somehow. He's making every excuse in the world. And if you know anything about Russell Simmons, smart man, smart, smart businessman. I think he saw a niche. He filled it. His work with hip-hop, I mean, there's a whole thing. There's a great book called Staring into Darkness, Brother Lester Spence. I'm going to have to get him on the podcast. It's about neoliberalism and hip-hop. And he makes some really interesting observations about Russell Simmons and his hip-hop political action committee coalition and how that was really just a way for them to get names for a mailing list so they can then send out information about their products targeting poor and working class black and brown people like this rush card. So, you know, when you're poor, you got a lot of taxes on you. You pay an extra for substandard food. You got to deal with food deserts. You got to deal with being charged more for basic financial services. You got to deal with all the anxiety. You have to deal with the life reality that it takes money to make money, opportunity costs, stress, decision making. It's hard being black. It's hard being poor. It's hard being white and poor. It's hard being brown and poor. And never mind our First Nations brothers and sisters. You know, I mean, that's a secret shame of a nation, folks. It really, really, really is. And we need some more reporting on the horrible ways that our First Nation brothers and sisters, everything happened to black people, but these cops, these thug cops killing people, it's happening worse to our First Nations brothers and sisters. So excited about Star Wars. I keep going back to Star Wars. I mean, there's so much to talk. I got to have self-control, self-control, self-control. Okay, calming down again. Without further ado, now, I did promise something for you last week. I said we're going to do our little Dear Prudence and Landers after the conversation with Dr. McAdam, where we deal with a question from last week on Slate.com, because I love to answer some of these questions. Woman wrote in, found out her husband, when he was a teenager, was diddling it, doing it with animals, bestiality. Well, I got some advice for her. And I also got, you know, I love to get these emails. Got an email from these right-wing sewer dweller interest groups trying to raise money for the 1% plutocrat Republicans who are drunk on a hallucinatory ideology of racism, neoliberalism, austerity, and culture cruelty, and nativism, no-nothing nativism. So they got an interesting little email fundraiser from Uncle Ben Carson. You read these things and say, someone's actually going to give this fool man some money. He is running a hustle on all these people. He is a grifter par excellence, and he is shaking down these racially resentful white folks who don't like black people as a group, but like their token special best black friend, Ben Carson, who's smiling and grinning as he cashes those checks. So that'll be after the conversation with Dr. McAdam. But Douglas McAdam, leading scholar, author of the great book Freedom Summer, about the Civil Rights Movement, his work on black insurgency and the political process model, essential if you want to understand social movement theory, political process model, very, very, very insightful, important, foundational in terms of thinking about social change and how we think about political opportunity structure. So it's not just resources. It's about the nature of the game, the terrain, and the interaction between the folks who are struggling, activists, elites, and others. Very dynamic model, very, very influential. And he's, like I said, he takes us in the Cadillac car. And we talk about Donald Trump. We talk about right-wing populism. We talk about the Tea Party. We talk about hacktivism, what do you want to call it? Folks going online with Twitter and hashtags, thinking they're changing the world, he and I, similar minds on that. Maybe it's not as extreme as some say, you got to be willing to die. But is just clicking like substantive political behavior? We talk about that. Black Lives Matter. How do we think about social movements? Does Black Lives Matter count, or would it qualify as a social movement? Where do they go next? How do we think about their agenda being borrowed, co-optated, taken, used by more mainstream traditional political actors like political parties? Black Lives Matter was mentioned at the Democratic debate. What does that portend? Where do we go next? So wide-ranging, interesting, smart conversation with an interesting, smart person doing interesting and smart things. You know the tagline here. It's the folks we bring you here on the podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. So that is the next segment. And as always, I want to thank all the folks who have donated to the podcast, to the website, Indomitable. Got a nice donation this week. Pleasant surprise from somebody who shall, you know, put people's business out in the street. I want to thank one of the folks who donated this week. We got subscribers. We got folks who randomly donate. We got our twice a year fundraiser, which is coming up in December, folks. Cover the opportunity cost of the podcast. All the folks who download, tweet, and share. And again, I always encourage folks, please, on iTunes, review the podcast. Folks are clicking on it, they're listening, that's great. But give us some stars, write some comments, because again, that helps with visibility. We know we don't have an empty room, I know I see the stats, but comments are great, positive or negative. Put some comments up there so a brother can work with that. If it's negative, I'll work and strive to try to respond and improve if need be. Positive, I just smile, because positive energy is a wonderful thing in this world. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful thing. But again, I want to thank all of you folks who listen, download, tweet, and share the podcast. Next segment. Sociologist Douglas McAdam, here on The Chauncey DeVega Show.
This land is your land, and this land is my land. From California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me. As I went a-walking that ribbon of highway, and I saw above me that endless skyway, I saw below me that golden valley. This land was made for you and me.
is your take on Donald Trump? And is it as simple as right-wing producerism and a certain convergence of racism and party polarization that's made this monster? Never mind reality TV.
Yeah, I think that's a lot of it. The other thing is that it really is the case that almost all the other candidates, that no one else has distinguished themselves. So if, in fact, the candidate, the Republican field starts to get, you know, narrowed down, a whole bunch of people are winnowed out, and it's Donald versus, say, three or four candidates, I think we'll start to see that there are real limits to Donald's support. But at this point, all the kind of generalized populist anger and racism can line up behind Trump, and none of the others are seen as the alternative. There's just a whole bunch of faceless folk, and not many of them have name anywhere near the name recognition that Donald does. Right now, I don't know what the polls show of the Republican primary polls, but you know, maybe he's getting 20-25% sort of support. It might not be all that much more than that, but everybody else is fighting for the remaining 75%, 80%, and there just isn't a viable alternative. You know, registered Republicans have not settled on somebody who might provide a more electable alternative to Trump. But I think what you say, a lot of it is exactly what you say. It's a scary reflection of just how much, I was going to say latent racism, but this is not latent at all.
No, it's not.
How much racism is out there, how much generalized populist alienation, anger, discontent, distrust of the political establishment is out there. And right now, Donald has gathered all that. You know, he's basically corralled all that. I'd like to think the amount of support he would get if he really became a serious nominee wouldn't be all that much more than we're seeing now, but I'm not persuaded that's true.
And on one hand, as a student of American politics and race and the color line and social movements more generally, it's like it's exhilarating in a weird, perverse way to see all the concepts and the vocabulary that we've developed actually coming to life with Donald Trump and sort of racial animus and symbolic racism. It's like I'm actually working on something as we speak, and I worked on it earlier, and I'm really struck by, and I'm making a list of concepts. And I was like, wow, you know, from the literature on critical race theory, whiteness studies, and so on. So list of concepts, for example, the idea of hair and vogue ideology, right-wing producerism, of course, symbolic racism,
right.
Front stage and backstage racism, thinking about the idea of right-wing populism. And I have a few other concepts I'm adding in there. So one is like, wow, you know, party polarization, the idea of normal politics, because the other hypothesis some other folks have written about, too, is Donald Trump just a reflection of the fact that normal politics is dead in terms of the conventional old-school Republican Party? So on one hand, it feels like, wow, you know, folks who study and think about these things, it's exhilarating because you're actually seeing these things come to life in the mainstream. But it's terrifying, too, and I just wish that more folks who had that specific academic and scholarly expertise got a chance to go on TV and radio and talk about this and actually do some real good public pedagogy.
I agree, because I do think we've generated a set of concepts that are helping us make sense of this rather strange and alternately terrifying and exhilarating moment.
But why do you think there aren't more folks who spent their time and years in training and they teach on the subject in the university and college, but they aren't going on TV? Is it just choice, or do you just think the discipline punishes it? Or
the discipline certainly doesn't reward it. In fact, in general, you know, if somebody really becomes a public intellectual, oftentimes they're seen as lightweight or something, I think is silly. So the reward structure of the disciplines don't encourage it. I would agree with that. But there's got to be receptivity on the other side. We're not often called upon by major media outlets to provide commentary. So I think it's a little bit of both.
I was also thinking, too, about political theater at the moment. And I was thinking back about your work on the Freedom Summer and the African-American Civil Rights Movement and civil rights movements more broadly. And this week, where now the right-wing media is christening that woman in, is it Kentucky, who's refusing to give our gay and lesbian brothers and sisters their marriage license.
Yes.
And they're saying that she's the new Rosa Parks. Never mind sort of the co-optation of brother Dr. Martin Luther King. It's sort of the simplistic understanding of the Great March on Washington for jobs, or just the black freedom struggle more generally. So when you see these moments, is it frustrating, or do you just shake your head in consternation?
A little bit of both. You know, as cynical as I've been about American politics most of my life, I couldn't honestly I couldn't honestly tell you that I expected at some point in my lifetime to be confronting the strangeness that we see in American politics now. In all honesty, I didn't believe when Obama was elected that we really had entered a post-racial world. The depths of racism in America are such that I knew that wasn't true, but I didn't actually think we'd see the sort of a return to the kind of explicit racism that was very common, say, in the 50s or even well into the 60s. The level of disrespect heaped on Obama has been quite stunning, in my view. And if someone had said, yeah, here's a candidate, somebody who's going to declare as a candidate for either party's presidential nomination in his announcement of his candidacy, he's going to say that lots of Hispanic, I don't know exactly how he phrased it, whether it was Hispanic or Mexican-American, immigrants are rapists and, you know, they bring drugs into the country and crime. I would have thought that might have ended that person's candidacy. And yet, clearly that helped catalyze his rise in the polls. It's quite stunning to me.
And your book will talk a great deal more about this. But do you think, you know, always trying to work through the puzzle? So we have the data. Then you have sort of, you know, you can look at the macro level picture. And you have on one hand the great hope that you have a president who happens to be black, who's really in a lot of ways just a Rockefeller Republican in another generation.
Yeah.
This isn't some black liberal progressive boogeyman. You know, Barack Obama, sincere, intelligent. We can certainly talk about sort of the anti-intellectualism of right-wing populism and the establishment movement conservatives today. But on one hand, as I said, you know, Obama gets elected, and we know from the research that his race and racial animus, I think it cost him, some of the recent research said about 5 percentage points,
right,
all things being equal.
Right.
But we want to make sense of it, and we also want to maintain our hope. But as you said, we spent all this time talking about the changing face of racism. We talk about the rise of dog whistle politics, the Southern strategy. Could it just be that maybe in the 24/7 news cycle where we have such extreme party polarization and a lack of a responsible commentary class or commentariat, that all things go at this point where Trump and the right wing's just overt racial animus is, we're just sort of numb to it, perhaps?
I do think that's right. And I do think your point about the variety of outlets now. I mean, you know, we might look back at the 50s, 60s, 70s or something and be critical of the kind of monopoly on political commentary enjoyed by the three networks and what was sort of organized out of political discourse by way of the kind of editorial norms and kind of centrist orientation of those networks. But basically, it did tend to have a kind of centralizing, moderating effect on political information and political discourse generally. We don't have that, obviously, at this point. And you know, if in the abstract or we celebrate the many voices, the fact of the matter is it allows for, you know, kind of self-perpetuating quality to political discourse and people's views. So if you're dedicated to the proposition that Barack Obama is, you pick it, the anti-Christ,
you know,
a socialist, etc., you can log on to 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 websites every morning that are dedicated to that very proposition to find the new, quote, evidence, unquote, to support that claim. You know, it's really produced a very different kind of political discourse and political information than was certainly the case 30, 40 years ago. And again, I'm not celebrating that exactly, the older media sort of establishment. But on the other hand, extremist views are much more present and influential in American politics now than at any time in my lifetime, certainly.
I always try to be careful when I summon his name, because very often I think folks sort of look to the past and foundational scholars and folks that, you know, names of the folks that the public may or may not know, and we can sometimes misspecify the argument. But when we're sort of thinking about polarization in the media and, again, the paranoid style in American politics, was Hofstadter more right than we want to give him credit for? I mean, was his claim almost universal that 50 years later we're still talking about him in terms of thinking about the politics of the moment?
I was critical of Hofstadter earlier in my career because I thought maybe his general perspective was increasingly less relevant. But geez, he looks very relevant at the present moment. Christopher Parker has argued very strongly that basically what we're seeing in the Tea Party really is Hofstadter's politics, or that extreme kind of paranoid style of politics being played out yet again in the United States. And I have no reason to disagree with Chris about that.
You know, you have Chris Parker, who does, I forgot the name of the actual research center at University of Washington or Washington University. And then you also have Theda Skocpol's great work on the Tea Party as well.
Right.
And you're actually sort of thinking about the good empirical work and the ethnographic work that people are doing. And I remember reading an article, but there's a researcher who studies white supremacist movements in this country and white nationalist groups. And what they described as sort of the Tea Party is actually a racializing environment for white group interests and grievances. So that the folks who join up with the Tea Party begin to think actively in racialized terms, whereas before, perhaps it was symbolic racism, or perhaps they would never say that they believe in the white identity movement. But white supremacists and white nationalists are skillfully exploiting all that animus, and the mainstream media just is asleep at the wheel on it.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. I mean, and I don't think, by the way, I don't think the Tea Party started out as all that racially focused. I mean, it's really interesting to me to sort of reflect back on, in some ways, how similar, in certain respects, the initial Tea Party and Occupy demonstrations mm-hmm. were. They actually, I'd say Occupy was more embedded in a certain political formation on the left, a kind of privileges, prefigurative politics, etc. But still, they were kind of colorful, noisy, amorphous demonstrations initially. And that's what the Tea Party was. You remember people would show up with funny tri-corner hats and, you know, they were kind of large, noisy, colorful gatherings, but they didn't seem to have the kind of the racial dimension that they've come to have. But if you look, again, if you look at Chris Parker's, his co-author is Barreto, if you look at the survey data they generated, and that's maybe 3 years old now, but those are the most powerful explanatory variables they're working with. And they put into their models all sorts of very conventional kind of political variables, you know, party identification, a bunch of ideological variables, mm-hmm. et cetera. But almost everything washes out except for hatred of Obama, racial resentment, whatever. I mean, that's a nice way to put that. And something called a social dominance orientation. That is, you know, these are individuals who do not believe, in fact, that all men are created equal or all people are created equal, that some are more deserving than others. And that obviously has a racial cast to it as well. Yeah, so I think the Tea Party structures, I think this varies, by the way, from location to location, but many of those Tea Party structures, organizations, formations clearly have amplified, have chosen to focus on and are amplifying the kind of racial reaction, the racial paranoia that's out there.
That, you know, you mentioned the social dominance theory and the rise of sort of, I wouldn't call it a soft authoritarianism, and a lot of these folks, it seems like an old-fashioned Adorno, F-scale, hard authoritarianism.
Right.
It's sometimes you turn on the TV, never mind the racial animus, and the, you know, the right-wing media's channeling and the Republican Party with Trump's, I would suggest, overt channeling of a lot of the worst sort of bigotry we see online and in other spaces. Sometimes you just don't know what year it is. So you don't have the overt racism of Jim and Jane Crow in the same way, but then you have folks trying to overturn the gains of the Civil Rights Movement, the Voting Rights Act, and to restrict voting.
Obviously, what's going on right now in terms of trying to restrict the franchise, it doesn't compare to, say, the Jim Crow South, where through a variety of means, essentially blacks were denied franchise. Nonetheless, that was a regional effort. This is really nationwide. The number of bills that have been proposed and the states in which they've been proposed pretty much covers the country as a whole. I think the motivation is very clear. You know, there is a demographic noose tightening around the Republican Party. It's become essentially a party of white racial conservatives, overwhelmingly. And yet the numbers, you know, the white percentage of the electorate is declining very rapidly. And to magnify the impact of white votes, you have to do everything you can to try to slow that demographic trend. And trying to come up with ways to restrict the franchise, not just to racial and ethnic minorities, but to Democratic constituents more generally, young people, the poor, etc. I think that's clearly what's going on. And every so often you get a Republican kind of official or party functionary who just says it, just lays it out there. This is transparent. And again, you've got a Supreme Court now that in its infinite wisdom has decided that the preclearance requirement of the Voting Rights Act is an anachronism. We've moved past that. It's mind-boggling to me because all the evidence you and I are talking about, really good, hard, empirical evidence, is that we're back in a period of extreme discrimination or the motivation to discriminate. And yet the Supreme Court has decided that, we've entered a kind of post-racial world when it comes to elections and we don't need those safeguards anymore. Well, we need them even more than we have for almost any time in the last 20, 30 years. And it is going to make it easier in 2016 for the Republicans actually to restrict the franchise in a number of states.
You know, and you have the long view as a senior expert, certainly, and scholar on the subject. But in terms of thinking about, you know, racial formation and American cultural and racial politics, maybe it's just my naivete. How come you can think about the smart move as opposed to the simplistic move? Whiteness and the folks who are considered white in America have historically changed. So almost by definition, whiteness is a racial construct that is dominant, right? And it's numerically superior. Why do you think sort of the smart folk in the Republican Party and the right wing at the think tanks aren't saying, okay, who are the next group of quasi-white ethnics to grandfather in to maintain our numerical and ideological superiority? Because I would think that would be the smarter long-term move. You know, maybe I'm just overthinking.
Whiteness has always been a kind of moving target of something that can shift over time. Damn, that's a great question. I don't have an answer. I mean, I think that would be stunning strategically to pull that off. But in the short run, they had another choice available to them. And in point of fact, I think the Republican establishment, to the extent that there is one, wanted to move in this direction. It also recognizes the demographic news tightening on the party. And after Romney was beaten in 2012, and especially given the significant role that Hispanic voters and increasing numbers of Hispanic voters played in that election, you know, there was a lot of talk actually among even Republican strategists that we have to reach out to Hispanic voters. And I actually still think, looking at 2016, there are Republican candidates who could potentially make significant inroads in the sort of distribution of Hispanic votes that Obama received, for instance, in both 2008, 2012. The split was roughly 3-1, 75-25. Both Bush and Rubio, and especially if you imagined a Bush-Rubio ticket, I think you could move those numbers in a really significant way and make this an absolute toss-up in terms of the general election. I think that's where the Republican establishment would like to go. One of the fascinating things about Trump is that he's just putting it out there, and I would never have thought of Trump as appealing to the base prior to hearing his discourse over the last 6 weeks or so. I didn't really take Trump that seriously, and I thought, well, my reading of the 2012 election was that it took too long for the Republican base to settle on Santorum as the sort of Tea Party alternative to Romney, who clearly the base did not like. Santorum actually did quite well in the middle primaries, but he had no money, so he had to shut it down. So I was thinking, gee, somebody like Walker, who actually came out of the last year, the kind of invisible primary, if you will, leading up to the actual primaries, came out of it with reasonable funds, some backing within the party, the kind of standing within establishment circles that Santorum never had. I thought, well, if Walker somehow early on gets seen as the viable alternative to Jeb Bush, he might actually be able to claim the nomination. I did not see Trump sort of muddying the waters in the way that he has. I think this is an extraordinary sort of struggle for control over the Republican Party. And we've been saying that since 2009, when the Tea Party really kind of roared to life. Trump is not exactly Tea Party, but he too has raised the issue about the heart and soul of the Republican Party is going to look like going forward. It's fascinating to watch. Redefining whiteness, I think there's another way you could go, which is actually to try to appeal to Hispanic voters with, you know, with comprehensive immigration reform, et cetera, et cetera.
And thinking about Trump very quickly again, because again, he's so fascinating, and you and analysts love the horse race, even though he's probably going to flame out. But as you said, the variable is he's got his own money. So it's his own reality show, and you have this war, so it seems, for the heart of the Republican Party. But going back to where I started with this right-wing producerism narrative, what surprises me about Trump is that you have the politics of racial alienation. You have, you pick an enemy who's an outsider, right?
Right.
But then you're supposed to, in this model, you know, the radical populists are then supposed to also hate rich people or bankers or somebody who's supposed to be pulling the strings. But you got a rich guy who's their figurehead.
Yeah. Yeah.
Who's trying to play their savior when one would think he would be the enemy.
Absolutely. Or a confusing figure that they couldn't possibly clearly instantly rally around him because the other associations with him are all wrong. You know, he basically hangs out in New York. He's extremely rich. He and Hillary have been friends. I mean, former Reagan advisors seriously tell one of the network analysts that he actually thought that Trump was working for the Democrats. Because it just, again, he thought it confounded all logic that this rich New Yorker who's palled around with the Clintons, apparently has a reasonably good relationship with Hillary, was suddenly muddying the Republican water, and he smelled a conspiracy.
Stranger things have happened. I wrote a piece at Salon, and folks laughed at me. And the analogy I've used for Trump, and other folk have echoed it at the New York Times, had a piece on it too, is he's a student of professional wrestling. And he's really the ultimate heel. Everything he's doing is learned from professional wrestling, and he's had a long-time association with the World Wrestling Federation.
That's true, that's true.
So who knows what the real story is?
Oh, I love that. Oh, my God, I think he does. He plays that
think about
perfectly.
It. He's the perfect villain. The way he talks down about his opponents, the way he insults them, the way he knows how to get heat from the media, his indifference, his arrogance.
Yeah.
He's a student of wrestling, and it works. He's a student of psychology. But thinking about this political moment again, and again, it's, you know, this is, again, a cousin to your great book, how do you sort of conceptualize or make sense of Black Lives Matter? I mean, is it a social movement? Because that's one of my anxieties, too, when folks want to say it's a social movement. I'm saying, well, by some of the definitions I'm familiar with, I'm not sure yet.
Yes and no. But it's interesting, the, you know, real generational split within the Black community around the movement, or around the phenomena, let's call it. And the younger activists who are very savvy in media terms and sort of have coined the hashtag, you know, kind of as disdainful of their older civil rights colleagues in the Black community as they are of white liberal politicians. In general, I would say among that younger generation who have really launched the phenomena, it doesn't look like a conventional social movement. It doesn't have a kind of, they're not appropriating mobilizing structures and engaging in other forms of kind of more conventional activism. Yes, there are crowds that take to the street that you can see as part of the phenomena, but certainly not under the control of the generation that has coined the hashtag and is pushing the moment. There are older civil rights organizations or figures who want to appropriate the energy of Black Lives Matter and do want to turn it into more conventional movement politics. You know, so they want to talk to police departments and they want to draw up a list of demands or goals, etc. And some of that is happening, so they're taking advantage of the energy and attention attached to the issue. But at least none of the figures younger figures who I associate with the phenomena have signed on to that more conventional movement dimension of the moment.
And I'm sitting here thinking, as I said, it's a hell of an intellectual puzzle that has real world implications. So on one hand, thinking about the generational divides around the politics of Black respectability or the Black, you know, the long Black freedom struggle and our various strategies and tactics, when you look at the generational divides with Black Lives Matter, do they echo in your mind the generational divides during the, you know, the classic moments, the 50s and 60s of the civil rights movement? Are these just recurring tensions around generational politics?
Yeah, I mean, in part, yes. There was a significant generational divide, obviously, in the kind of modern civil rights movement. King himself and other, King was, trying to remember how old he would have been in Montgomery, like 32, something like that. And most of the other ministers that align with the movement and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference were also young and publicly respectful, but backstage very critical of the feet of clay of their elders, especially within the black church. I mean, everybody says, oh, yes, the heart of the civil rights movement was the black church. The black church as an institution remained very conservative. Heyday of the civil rights movement, there were particular ministers and congregations that certainly helped to mobilize the struggle and sustain the struggle, but the church as a whole remained conservative. And prior to sort of the rise of King and that generation of black ministers, the church had been roundly criticized by people like Du Bois for its inherent conservatism. So there was a generational divide. Then there was another generational divide that developed and was highlighted by the relationship between, say, King and SNCC, where that more radical younger generation also was critical offstage, mostly, about King and his unwillingness to address economic issues and consider self-defense or other more radical tactics, etc. So, you know, yeah, you absolutely see these kind of generational divisions playing out in earlier episodes, other episodes of the freedom struggle. This one is a little bit different to me because it comes with such different understandings or different conceptions of what movements should look like and what tactics should be predominant. The new online technologies are changing the political discourse and social movements. It isn't clear to me whether those changes actually make movements more or less effective. Because they say, well, you know, information is instantaneous. You can mobilize people quicker. Yes, you can get people in the streets, but it's not clear that they actually are operating with a common set of understandings. And if historically movements have been effective to the extent that they've been able to disrupt or threaten to disrupt business as usual, politically and economically, you have to ask, what are the new online technologies capable of doing that? Now, at the extreme, hacktivism, there are forms of online activism that can be profoundly disruptive. But putting a hashtag out there and expressing anger does not in itself disrupt, in my view. And so, yes, the generational divisions have always been a part of movement dynamics, but typically the younger activists in those generational struggles are pushing for more threatening tactics. It's not clear to me that most forms of online activism are in fact more effective or more in the sense of being more threatening or disruptive.
And this will be provocative, and folks can email me, as they often do, if they don't like what respectfully disagree. As we say, we're all friends at the virtual bar and salon, known as the Chauncey DeVega Show, as I like to say on the podcast. That is online activism and hacktivism, and is that just empty symbolic politics? Or is it some sort of pre-political behavior? Because I go back and forth on it. You know, my example in my own research is, you know, thinking about hip-hop and black youth politics and just populist politics, and I'm a student of Jim Scott as well and respect his work, nothing is more paradoxical to me than a bunch of, you know, rich, upper-class, white, middle-class kids wearing Che Guevara T-shirts while they're, you know, Trustafarians wearing Che Guevara T-shirts trying to engage in radical politics. You know, so at what point, and that's very often where the radical class comes from. They come from the moneyed classes who have the resources, but is all this online stuff, beyond just organizing and using it as a tool, do you think it's empty symbolic politics that doesn't accomplish anything? Or do we just not know? I mean, we don't have enough data, perhaps.
You know, and again, I don't think we've necessarily, you know, either on the right or left, I don't think that the forms of disruptive politics or disruptive kind of movement politics have yet really emerged out of the new technologies. There are some examples, but in general, when I watch sitting on college campus and watching people engage in what they see as forms of online politics, it feels like it substitutes for other more, it doesn't lead to more offline politics, offline mobilization. It substitutes for. And for many people, I watch them feel good about claim that they are active in a movement because they posted a like to some blog or they've signed a petition and so forth. I'm not putting those activities down, but to the extent that they remain individualized, they're not aggregated in ways that actually do disrupt, and they allow for a certain kind of empty identity politics. I worry about future effectiveness of movements as a distinctive form of politics. Again, as I said before, my read of social movements historically is that they've been successful to the extent that they serve to disrupt or threaten to disrupt business as usual. But, you know, social movements, what is a social movement is constantly changing. You know, this is very much a work in progress, and the current forms of online movement politics seem to me to be too often, as you say, empty symbolism, and doesn't aggregate into the kinds of more sustained disruptive forms of activism that have been the hallmark of movements in the past. But again, absolutely believe that there are forms of disruptive movement politics that could come out of those new technologies, or more effective ways to integrate online and offline. But I don't think anybody's really hit on them yet or used them in some systematic way of the moment.
And I'm sitting here thinking, as I said, it's a hell of an intellectual puzzle that has real-world implications. So on one hand, thinking about the generational divides around the politics of black respectability or the long black freedom struggle and our various strategies and tactics, when you look at the generational divides with Black Lives Matter, do they echo in your mind the generational divides during the classic moments, the 50s and 60s of the Civil Rights Movement? Are these just, you know, recurring tensions around generational politics?
Yeah, I mean, in part, yes. There was a significant generational divide, obviously, in kind of modern civil rights movement. King himself and other, I mean, King was, trying to remember how old he would have been in Montgomery, like 32, something like that. And most of the other ministers that aligned with the movement and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference were also young and publicly respectful, but backstage very critical, the feet of clay of their elders, especially within the black church. I mean, everybody says, oh, yes, the heart of the civil rights movement was the black church. The black church, as an institution, remained very conservative for the heyday of the civil rights movement. There were particular ministers and congregations that certainly helped to mobilize the struggle and sustain the struggle, but the church as a whole remained conservative. And prior to sort of the rise of King and that generation of black ministers, the church had been roundly criticized by people like Du Bois for its inherent conservatism. So there was a generational divide. Then there was another generational divide that developed and was highlighted by the relationship between, say, King and SNCC, where that more radical younger generation also was critical offstage, mostly, about King and his unwillingness to address economic issues and consider self-defense or other more radical tactics, etc. So, yeah, you absolutely see these kind of generational divisions playing out in earlier episodes of, you know, other episodes of the freedom struggle. This one is a little bit different to me because it comes with such different understandings or different conceptions of what movements should look like and what tactics should be predominant. I mean, we know the new online technologies are changing political discourse and social movements. It isn't clear to me whether those changes actually make movements more or less effective. Because, well, you know, information is instantaneous. You can mobilize people quicker. Yes, you can get people in the streets, but it's not clear that they actually are operating with a common set of understandings. And if historically movements have been affected to the extent that they've been able to disrupt or threaten to disrupt business as usual, politically and economically, you have to ask, what are the new online technologies capable of doing that? Now, at the extreme, hacktivism, there are forms of online activism that can be profoundly disruptive. But putting a hashtag out there and expressing anger does not in itself disrupt, in my view. The generational divisions have always been a part of movement dynamics, but typically the younger activists in those generational struggles are pushing for more threatening tactics. It's not clear to me that most forms of online activism are in fact more effective or more in the sense of being more threatening or disruptive.
And this will be provocative, and folks can email me, as they often do, if they don't like what respectfully disagree. As we say, we're all friends at the virtual bar and salon known as the Chauncey DeVega Show, as I like to say on the podcast. That is online activism and hacktivism, and is that just empty symbolic politics? Or is it some sort of pre-political behavior? Because I go back and forth on it. Is all this online stuff, beyond just organizing and using it as a tool, do you think it's empty symbolic politics that doesn't accomplish anything? Or do we just not know? I mean, we don't have enough data.
I don't think we know. I don't think we've necessarily, either on the right or left, I don't think that forms of disruptive politics or disruptive kind of movement politics have yet really emerged out of the new technologies. There are some examples, but in general, when I watch, sitting on college campus and watching people engage in what they see as forms of online politics, it feels like it substitutes for other more, it doesn't lead to more offline politics, offline mobilization, it substitutes for. And for many people, I watch them feel sort of good about and claim that they are active in a movement because they posted a like to some blog or they've signed a petition and so forth. I'm not putting those activities down, but to the extent that they remain individualized, they're not aggregated in ways that actually do disrupt, allow for a certain kind of empty identity politics. I worry about future effectiveness of movements as a distinctive form of politics. Again, as I said before, my read of social movements historically is that they've been successful to the extent that they serve to disrupt or threaten to disrupt business as usual. What is a social movement is constantly changing. You know, this is very much a work in progress. The current forms of online movement politics seem to me to be too often, as you say, empty symbolism and doesn't aggregate into the kinds of more sustained disruptive forms of activism that have been the hallmark of movements in the past. But again, I absolutely believe that there are forms of disruptive movement politics that could come out of those new technologies or more effective ways to integrate online and offline, but I don't think anybody's really hit on them yet or used them in some systematic way.
You know, and the integration of sort of the online and digital, you know, because political behavior is a continuum, right? So we have pre-political, symbolic, then we have sort of more formal behavior in the public sphere, then we have obviously advocating or pressing for policy changes, redress of grievances, et cetera, et cetera. But I was remembering a story, you know, I grew up, my father was a maintenance man at Yale University, and he always bring me to work with him. And he would leave me with professors and graduate students and all the interesting people that he thought I should sit down and talk to. So I'm like 9, 10, 11, and he'd always let me skip school. So one of the folks that he would leave me with is, he was a former Black Panther. I guess he still considers himself a Black Panther. And he was one of the Panthers that was on trial in the New Haven case back in the 60s.
Oh, my God.
And I remember this bookstore, you know, Yale downtown has since gentrified, and it's lost all its personality. And I remember talking to him. I was about 12 or 13, and later in his life he developed cancer when I was in college, but I'd still stop and talk to him. And I was all enamored with black cultural politics and populism and the idea of the subaltern in resistance. And he said something to me, maybe it's too old school, but he said something to me I'll never forget. He said, "It's not really a social movement or politics unless you're willing to die." And he's like, "If you're not willing to die," he's like, "I don't want to hear it." Now, that bar is a little high. We're thinking about sort of, you know, traditional pluralism or maybe like mainstream normal politics. But it does make me think about sort of online activism is symbolic and not empty, but we just don't know yet. I was also thinking, you've most certainly probably read the books on it, some of the new scholarship about the Arab Spring and the use of social media. And I forgot the author's name, but one of his findings was on the use of Twitter and Facebook is that, number one, it gives the state another way to suppress and repress publics because now they can monitor you and turn it off.
Right.
But he had I don't know if it was in the Chronicle, he did an interview, but he also said that the folks he was mobilizing and he's talked to, because he's also involved as a movement activist, he said they would have been there anyway.
Yeah.
It just made it more convenient. So maybe that's the dilemma, that maybe we're getting a lot of folks who are free riders, like we always have in many movements, but maybe the core group of activists would still, you know, participate.
When people say, oh, but come on, information is exchanged, you know, much more instantaneously, surely this facilitates mobilization. I don't buy it. I don't buy it. It facilitates forms of mobilization that are too easy and that allow for kind of nothing more than a kind of online imprint. The civil rights movement didn't have the benefit of any of these forms of instantaneous communication. They seemed to do quite well with phone trees or whatever else they were using. And as you point out, I think this is a really important point that people don't take on board enough, and that is that these new technologies essentially provide both a way to communicate with your potential followers as a movement organizer, but also, you know, your opponent is spending increasing amounts of time trying to figure out how to use those very same technologies for the purposes of surveillance and suppression. Especially when you add that dimension into the equation, I think our overly optimistic views about the revolutionary liberating potential of these new technologies is hugely overstated.
So thinking too, we've had a few guests on in the past. We had a great guest, writer for the New York Times, historian, talking about the civil rights movement and the Cold War. Other folks had, he writes for the Opinionator section on the Civil War. He's going to call me up and yell at me for forgetting his name. Dr. Gregory Downs. And we had a great conversation about Reconstruction and the idea of how African Americans came to understand the state as being a savior in the face of white racial terrorism. And I'm just wondering, in terms of thinking about sort of the nuanced stories that we tell about history versus public memory, why do you think that, again, the general public thinks about the civil rights movement in terms of Dr. King? They think about marches. They think about freedom riders. Perhaps they think about martyrs, white, brown, and other who were killed in the pursuit of human rights. Why do you think sort of the nuance, for example, I'll throw you one out there, sort of the idea about the political opportunity structure in the Cold War is really left out of the narrative? Because when I write about that or share that with students or other folks and say, you know, the political opportunity structure was central and elites were central to thinking about the black freedom struggle, they're either ignorant of it or they look at me like I'm crazy and I've offended them.
Yeah. There has been an African-American freedom struggle coming, approaching 400 years. You know, resistance to this oppressive institution or set of institutions has always been there. It's not as if the movement burst to life in 1955 because Rosa Parks was sick and tired of being sick and tired. But there's a reason why elites responded differently in 1955 and 56. We want to tell fairly simple heroic narratives about all the movements that have reshaped American life. We tend to tell them in a way that suggests these were kind of unified, top-down struggles led by identifiable leaders, and that basically it was the courage and conviction of the, not just the leaders, but the rank and file who filled out the movement that accounts for the movement's successes. I would be the first one to acknowledge the courage, heroism, et cetera, of movement activists, especially given the context in which they were operating, the southern United States, well, elsewhere in the country as well. That said, the real story about movements is much more complicated, and it really does involve real shifts in kind of the broader political economic context that made the oppressive system more or less vulnerable to challenge at particular points in time. It's not just that the Cold War put the American state under enormous pressure to kind of bring to put its racial house in order. It's also that the economic importance of cotton was just nothing in the 1950s compared to what it had been in 1900, 1910, 1920. So the economic logic of this particular system or set of political and economic institutions had been badly eroded by the, you know, essentially the decline of King Cotton. The other thing that I think is really important, we mostly tell the story of these movements by focusing on the forms of public protest that, you know, were most visible. So whether that's the Freedom Rides or the March on Washington or even the riots. But there was tremendous amount of institutional activism that was going on all over the country during that period and continues to go on today. As you say, elites, political and economic elites, were playing a very different role in those later years than they were in the earlier period. Their interest began to align at least with a moderate version of civil rights reform, if not the kind of more radical version that the movement, or at least segments of the movement, wanted. So the stories we tell tend to be incredibly simplistic and kind of movement-centric, if you will. And without denigrating the importance of the movement, other factors come into play. The opposition to racism and racial discrimination is more or less a constant in the American experience. So you can't really explain when the particular chapters of that struggle achieve, considerable success. I think you have to think more deeply about the broader political and economic context in which those struggles occur.
I'm thinking about how we periodize social movements for the sake of parsimony and study, and I'm so happy that you mentioned the idea, again, that the black freedom struggle has been going on for centuries. Thinking about, you know, your work certainly, but Han's work,
yeah.
A Nation Under Our Feet, a lot of, you know, the great, you know, historians, black, white, brown, red, other, folks who've, you know, pointed out sort of thinking about power and resistance, but for the purposes of writing journal articles and books and for communicating with the public, it's a lot easier to say we're studying this time period from these years to these years with these attributes. But then trying to always, when we communicate with folks, to be careful to say, you know what, resistance didn't just start with Rosa Parks, who herself was a trained activist,
right,
who wasn't a little old lady. You know, I love, you know, storytelling and sharing. I'm sure you've got some great stories from the classroom, too. I was giving a talk about the black freedom struggle in a class I was teaching on race and ethnic relations, one of those wonderfully generic titled classes that you can do anything you want. And we were talking about the civil rights movement, and I have always had to be reminded that sometimes I'm now closer to 40, certainly, than I was at the time to 30. But for a lot of students and others, I mean, these narratives, just like other folks, are how they think about themselves. They're not abstractions. It's not an empirical or historiographical question. So we're talking about Rosa Parks, and I just made the joke. I said, yeah, you know, she wasn't a little old lady. And she was trained, and she was in her 30s, and black folks didn't all of a sudden just decide to stop sitting on buses. This was real politics and resistance. And this young black woman, and she said, Rosa Parks is her hero, and how dare I insult Rosa Parks' memory, and it's not fun. She went off.
Yeah.
And I was like, no, this is actually a good thing to think about human beings having agency and organizing and resisting. But she would have none of it, and she got up and walked out of the room and was never to be seen again. But it was one of those moments where you're just like, I can't believe it.
You had impugned her hero, heroine. More importantly, you know, you had messed with this very appealing kind of simple narrative account of someone just putting their foot down finally, an ordinary person responding. Well, yeah, Rosa Parks was, you know, all of us are ordinary at some level, but she was pretty extraordinarily positioned to act in the way she did.
And never mind all the other, you know, the new scholarship about sort of thinking about her relationship and the black women and womanist movement. They weren't called womanists then. To sort of think about sexual assault.
Yeah.
And rape in that moment, and that she was part of this broader movement to resist Jane Crow.
Yeah.
And as I said, you know, for maybe for us, the complexity enriches the story, but maybe folks have their heroes and they want the simple story.
I can't remember who wrote, somebody said that, you know, if you want to mobilize people, you need a kind of congenital, almost false optimism, and the complexity and challenges of resisting any really deeply oppressive system, you know, that's going to be very, very difficult. Something about a kind of simplifying narrative that gives hope maybe is part of the social psychology of struggle. It may well be. But I'm with you. I actually think we dignify those struggles and understand them much better to the extent that we complicate them. The other one, and I'll do it really quickly. Oh, the modern civil rights movement is born in Montgomery in 55, and from then, and it's led by Martin Luther King, and then from then on, at least until the end of the 60s, early 70s, it's a kind of progressive struggle forward and upward. The white resistance to Not just to Montgomery, but actually to the Supreme Court decision, the Brown decision in 55, is so extraordinary, 54, sorry, is so extraordinary in the South. There's this massive white resistance to the threats to the Southern way of life posed by Montgomery and the Brown decision. And if you look at actual movement events in 57, 58, 59, they are in sharp decline. Essentially, the movement is moribund by early 1960. It's the sit-ins that revive the movement, and they have nothing to do with King. That's actually a kind of separate chapter, but that's what really revitalizes the modern civil rights movement and kicks it into high gear.
It's a natural pivot to talking about your book in more detail. So thinking about the civil rights movement and resistance and sort of the political and social, because it really was, you know, we don't want to denigrate those amazing changes. Always being careful to always sort of honor, you know, the black freedom struggle in that moment and all the participants and the folks who strategized, bled, died, and again, faced massive resistance, white racial terrorism, the state, etc., the Bull Connors of the world. But how are those moments still resonating and complicating our politics today, some 50 or 60 years later?
I think they do.
Or naturally lead to, sort of thinking about the realignments and the end of Jim and Jane Crow and how they've led to our polarized politics today.
There is another more complicated answer to that, but let me start with, yeah, I think in my view, the really unanticipated consequence, or one of the unanticipated consequences of arguably the singular achievement of the civil rights movement, the modern civil rights or the 50s, 60s civil rights movement, was the redemocratization of voting rights in the South. But as blacks registered in large numbers and poured into the Democratic Party structures of the South, you know, white racists fled to the Republican Party. And the origins of today's deeply polarized, deeply racialized politics are in that moment of singular achievement, but the impact of that was to effectively break apart the New Deal coalition, this unholy alliance of Southern racists, basically, and Northern liberal labor-type Democrats. As long as the South remained deeply loyal to the Democrat, well, it's not loyalty to the Democratic Party. It's deep hatred of the Republican Party, that is the party of Lincoln, which brought the War of Northern Aggression on the South. As long as white Southerners were absolutely loyal to the Democratic Party, the Democrats enjoyed a significant electoral advantage, and they were able to remain largely in power at the national level from the time of Roosevelt until Nixon's election in 68. And that 36-year period is arguably the period of most sustained liberal policymaking the country has ever known. Once the kind of regional structure of the kind of racial geography of American politics shifts in the 60s, you begin to create an electoral foundation for a resurgent and increasingly conservative, especially racially conservative, Republican Party. And that's the moment we're talking about now. These stories about the intersection of movement and more conventional electoral politics are fascinating, and they have powerfully shaped American life, the prospects for social change, for all of our history.
And what was the light bulb for the book? Because, I mean, your book weaves together questions of polarization, wealth inequality, and racial animus. Was it sort of just the culmination, the sort of, you know, reading the tea leaves and looking at the literature and seeing what we're grappling with today and saying, okay, I got to come up with an answer for this, or at least propose some answers and new questions, or is it something else?
No, you got it. I mean, personally, I was deeply depressed, frustrated by what was happening, and I didn't fully understand how we had gone from the striking bipartisanship and comparative economic equality of the post-World War II period to these almost unprecedented divisions of today. I mean, and I'm talking about three different levels of division: economic, the extreme inequality, the political polarization, and then this rising tide of racial animus, the kind of racial division that you and I have been talking about quite a bit. How did we get there? And again, if we like simple-minded narratives about movements, we love the idea America, the American story, is a progressive march towards a fuller realization of the democratic promise inherent in the founding of the nation. Well, we're so far away from that. We've taken so many steps back economically, politically, and racially. How did that happen? That was the motivating question for underlying the book. So you had it exactly right.
Just two big questions before we sort of talk about where folks can find you online, future projects, things you're reading, and the like. I'm not a fan of conspiracy theories, because a conspiracy is just, you know, two people acting perhaps in private for their own gain against that of others. So the story is a bit more complicated than that. But in terms of thinking about sort of shifting demographics, which certainly wouldn't fit into that, but I'll rephrase it. Sort of thinking about our political terrain, is the sort of dysfunction that we're seeing in terms of polarization, in terms of the media, in terms of racial animus, is this a function of sort of, you know, just the ecological fallacy at work? Is just the world as it is and forces come hither and thither? Or were there certain key decisions made by policy actors that produced the electoral and social mess that we're both concerned about?
No simple conspiracy, but there were actual moments where, you know, conservative actors, you know, made decisions that certainly have shaped the course of the last 30, 40 years, and the sort of trends that we're talking about in terms of increasing inequality, political polarization, et cetera. Capital really did mobilize in the early to mid-70s in a way that it hadn't previously, and it was encouraged to do so by former Supreme Court Justice Powell, who put out a very significant memo. I'm going to miss the year, 72, 73, memo or speech, I can't remember. But where he, you know, in this, even though we're talking about 1972 and Nixon is in the White House, this is a period where you could argue kind of the forces of regulation and the liberal state, the welfare state, were probably at pretty much their high watermark, and capital was feeling very threatened by all those developments. Powell sort of laid out, basically called attention to those trends and laid out in broad relief a strategy for mobilizing in response to those threats. And the capital really did mobilize and has continued to mobilize and shape, you know, policy in Washington in ways that they never had previously. I think Reagan's election and the policies that he pursued marked a real crucial turning point in American politics and policymaking. As we point out in the book, I mean, and this was something of a surprise to me in doing the research, Reagan's achievements in office were actually fairly modest, but he set in motion a whole series of trends that continued after he left office. So the Reagan Revolution, to the extent that it happens, and it really does happen, is of a slow release variety, and it really takes another 10 years or so after he's left office to fully redefine the parameters of federal policymaking in the U.S. I mean, he is as important a figure as Roosevelt was. The Roosevelt Revolution, I mean, Roosevelt basically helped cement a consensus that held, a bipartisan consensus that held until Reagan, that the role of the federal government legitimately was to address disadvantage, was to try to level playing fields. That was the role, principal role and function of the federal government. Reagan basically called that into question And, you know, another way to look at our present moment is we are deeply divided around two incompatible visions of what the federal government should be about. The traditional sort of liberal democratic vision that it is, you know, is we associate with Roosevelt and the post-war period, and then Reagan arguing that the problem is in fact the federal government. Taxes should, big government does two horrible things. It reduces entrepreneurial drive on the one hand, and then on the other hand, it creates unhealthy dependence on the state on the part of the disadvantaged. Those are Romney's 47%, mm-hmm. right? So Reagan really did fundamentally muddy the waters about what the federal government, the legitimate role the federal government ought to be, and we have not resolved that issue at all. We've got those two incompatible visions still sort of competing with each other. That's why there's such gridlock in Washington, why essentially we no longer have a functioning legislative branch at the national level, the federal level.
So obviously we have good old Mr. Norquist, make the government so weak you can drown it in a bathtub like a baby.
Yeah.
And then you have, you know, the irony again, sort of this corporate democratic model where you have the corporations, which basically, and the 1% and the plutocrats, which really are a dependent class
yes.
on the federal government.
Yes.
While having the rhetoric of talking about useless eaters and the 47%. But a concluding huge question, a softball, or perhaps it's a lot harder than I think it is. How do we, again, think about social movements and people's movements in a country where, you know, Bartels and Gillens and others have documented great new research that in a lot of ways really isn't a democracy traditionally understood? It's the deep state, it's interest groups, it's the 1%. So what are people to do in this moment?
The history of the U.S., and this applies both to the right and the left, we have powerful forces that defend the status quo, and we have long periods of relatively little change in sort of levels of economic inequality, say, or political polarization. The big significant shifts in American history have come about as largely as a result of sustained mobilized movements. The right has commanded that space pretty effectively, I would argue, for the last, say, 30 years, for 30, 40 years, the Tea Party being only the most recent example. The left remains badly fragmented, but to the extent that we want to kind of push the pendulum in the other direction, it will require, I think, a sustained progressive movement to do that. That's my general reading of American politics, and I think it applies as much today as it ever has.
I mean, a hopeful vision for these times of troubles, austerity, surveillance, and neoliberalism. So I'm glad you're that you're forward-thinking and think that there's hope, because a lot of folks have just basically said, hands up, there's nothing that we can do. So hopefully hope will stay alive, as muddled as that sounds. But I just want to ask you very quickly, where can folks find you online? Where can they get the book, and what future projects do you have upcoming?
I am not online. I mean, you can get...
Or your email, or...
Stanford maintains a website for every department and every faculty member on campus, so you can get to a website, you know, for Doug McAdam at Stanford University. My email is mcadam@stanford.edu. The book is available, obviously, through Amazon. It's also available from the Oxford University Press website. There's going to be a paperback edition that will be available as of January or February, which will include a new section on sort of looking to 2016, that is trying to understand the various cross pressures shaping the general election in 2016. Other projects, they don't really fall into this vein. I've got a couple other research projects, but they're so unrelated, I'm not sure that it makes sense to talk about them here.
You don't mind sharing, you don't want to get scooped, but if just generally speaking, I'm just curious.
I've got an ongoing research project with a couple of graduate students where we've looked at sort of the civic effects, if you will, of two very different approaches to school reform, charter schools being one, and the other being a kind of inter-district transfer program in which every year 200-plus disadvantaged students from a neighboring district are allowed to enroll in the better neighboring district. And we've, through interviews and surveys and ethnographic research, have tried to understand whether or not, beyond the academic effects of these forms of school reform, whether there are tangible civic effects, whether people's attitudes are different, whether their generalized sense of political efficacy is greater, whether the forms of civic behavior they engage in, you know, are more extensive, etc. So that's a project that, in fact, we're just now starting to write up the results in the form of a book that's already under contract.
Sitting here in Chicago with all the school troubles and the narrative around charter schools, because, I mean, that's just a rich project I can't wait to look out for, because with the school choice and reform movement, again, it's neoliberalism 101,
exactly.
But you have all this language of civic inclusion and responsibility, choice, efficiency, opportunity, and the way that they use those narratives to try to get poor black and brown and white folks to sign up for these charter schools that have very questionable outcomes.
Absolutely.
Never mind the assault on the idea of the commons and the public that we should have public schools. So that sounds really exciting.
We've hollowed out our notion of, you know, or hollowed out our commitment to, you know, this is one of the great American ideas, was the idea of free public education. Right. Boy, have we moved far away from that.
Wow. So I look forward to that. But Dr. McAdam, I want to thank you one more time. Your work has been a huge influence on my own. And as I said, the idea of the political process model, freedom, summer and civil rights, and your new work is just so important. And I just want to thank you for taking time on a holiday to sit down and chat, because it was very, very meaningful. And I'm sure the listeners will get a lot out of it.
Hey, you know, it always feels a little odd to be thanked to do something that's so engaging. And you are a phenomenal host.
Well, thank you very much. See, you made a black man blush a little bit. I can go back to finish my Coca-Cola, but we'll certainly stay in touch, because I can't wait to hear about your new research. But I just want to thank you one more time. It's much appreciated.
Absolutely. You too. Thanks a million.
Great, great, great conversation. I want to thank Dr. McAdam one more time. Again, so cool when you can talk to somebody whose work you admire. And I really am sitting there smiling while he and I were chatting, because it's like, yes, number one, I didn't misread his work. So that's always good. He didn't have to do the gentle corrective, the yes and, or yes, but, or not really. So he was cool with that. And I hear somebody, again, we were sharing those stories about, how do you think about the long black freedom struggle? That this is not something that happened over 50 years. This is a centuries and centuries and centuries of resistance in the new world across the black Atlantic, here in what would eventually become the United States. So that was wonderful to hear. But the big question becomes, what does Black Lives Matter do next? And of course, you got detractors. That damn Mr. McWhorter, whose work on linguistics and language I so appreciate, he is just a professional black contrarian. Yeah, I think it was Washington Post. Of course, he has a piece, again, Black Lives Matter must deal with black-on-black crime. Number one, let's stop talking about the lie of black crime. We only have crime. And two, a lot of the Black Lives Matter activists are deeply involved in trying to stop the gun violence. And unfortunately, many ghetto underclass black communities. We have an American violence problem. But you can get a black person to go up there and parrot that piss-poor logic, because somehow, if Black Lives Matter is not willing to deal with crime by street thugs and brigands, somehow their claims about the state killing black and brown people who are armed and are innocent people, all variety, we got them killing armed people, unarmed people, people walking down the street, sleeping in cars in their houses, is somehow one claim invalidates the other. I don't even try to work through that logic. And again, it's just sort of the meaning of the value of black life and a basic understanding that the state shouldn't kill its own citizens. Newsflash. That damn Mr. McWhorter, he is whizzable. Challenging, a nuisance in many ways. I love his other work, but just because you know about Baskin Weaving 101 don't mean you know anything about Baskin Weaving 102 or 103. At least get the facts right. If you want to, I think it was Washington Post, track down that hot mess. But again, Dr. McAdam, I want to thank him. So generous with his time and all his great sharing. So I was hinting at our two things. Now, I like to give advice. I don't follow my own advice. My life would be so much. I can give some advice, though. Am I the only one like that? You sit down with me under the learning tree. I'll figure out all your problems. Don't ask me about my own life, though. My own life, a hot mess. So many decisions to be made, folks. I'm thinking seriously about, and you could email me if you think I should do this. It's an idea. It's not something that will happen soon because the plate is pretty full and I got some other big decisions I need to make by September, which is the deadline I gave myself. I'm starting to think, you know, I started the podcast because I got tired of waiting for invitations to go on the radio. I said, you know, I like talking. I like dialoguing. I like exchanging ideas with interesting and smart people. Why wait for folks to come to you when you can do it yourself? And lo and behold, we are here now. Just recorded some more episodes. We're going to be able to cross 100 at some point. We're at 70-something. I got 20 more. Yeah, we're going to be over 100. Amazing, cool folks lined up that have already chatted. I'm going to give them all away. I'm seriously thinking, and you can email me, chaunceydevega.com, what you think about this, doing some sort of video YouTube show. I know people who with skills in production who can give me some advice and insights Time always matters. We know that. It would be a time commitment. I still do the podcast, the website, the other writing, of course. But, you know, I think there's a niche there. I'm tired of waiting for other invitations that, unfortunately or not, come in this frequently. Once a month, twice a month, we got to be out there twice a week. We got to be out there twice a week. So I'm thinking maybe that would be something I would seriously consider. So if you folks think yay or nay, email me. Tell me you think we should have like a half hour show, 15, 20 minute show. Maybe occasionally bring it on guests, but just me cutting some promos. Think about the Young Turks, that sort of format when it first started out, something like that. I think we could make that happen, have a Kickstarter, do a little fundraiser, get the monies together for the equipment we need. I'm seriously thinking about it. So if you want to second me on that, send me an email. Say, Chauncey, that's the worst idea ever. You know what? That's a gold mine. Go for it, because I would watch it. So that's just me. That's spontaneous, because we do what comes to mind here. That was something I was mulling over, and I said, let me just process that, because I'm seriously considering doing it. So advice. I like reading these advice columns because they're an insight. Number one, a lot of it is BS of the mind. I don't think this slate probably does this, but who knows? I don't know anything about the behind the scenes of the advice column business. I think sometimes people make stuff up and they just write, they come up with these fictive people and their problems and they send stuff in. But sometimes you read something and it's, even if they're trolling you, it's still mighty entertaining. So I promised this last week. So I'm going to read you, as I pull it up here on the computer screen, I'm going to read problem that was sent in to dear. I'm getting comfortable. Here, wait a minute. Flavor saver. Hold on. I give advice. I got to have the flavor. Hold on. Oh, the flavor saver. That's an extended scratch to get us ready. And a swig of the ginger ale. Ooh, that's so good. So good. So here is a letter to dear Prudence. All right. I'm going to try not to laugh. Now, this was sent in last week. And you folks tell me what you would do. Now, somebody apparently has this problem. Why are you laughing? All right, take people's concerns seriously. I need advice about something I can't ask anyone else. I have been with my boyfriend for 2 years. He is charming, funny, and my best friend. We both have good careers, share common interests, and love each other very much. However, he confessed something horrible to me the other night. He grew up on a farm and a ranch with a very conservative and religious family and was homeschooled. Ray, quote unquote, did not receive an early education about sex and was not allowed to talk about it or ask questions. At age 12, while looking for answers on the internet, oh boy, he found porn. Some of it was bestiality. He then participated in these atrocious activities from age 12 to 15. Ray went to public high school at 15, finally learned about sex and found girls. He's not been back to this practice for more than 10 years and feels an incredible sense of regret, shame, and guilt about it. I'm the first person he has ever told. I am shocked, disgusted, and fearful of what this means for his psyche. He refuses to see a therapist. I feel so overwhelmed by this confession that I don't know what to do. Should I have packed my bags that night? Do I seek counseling? Can we move forward? Please help me process this. She gives her nice, supportive response, basically saying, don't worry about the guy. He knows what he did was wrong. Deal with it. He's good people. Now, Chauncey DeVega is a bit more judgmental than that. So let us speak a little truth to power about this sex freak. Yeah, I'm being judgmental. Judgmental. We are born between urine and feces. If I have the prophetic fire inspired by Charlie Parker Mingus Porter, with the sensibilities of Ray Charles. That's my little Cornel West giving advice imitation there. So you got this man. Let me explain this, folks, to this woman. If she and I were sitting down talking to each other, I'd explain this to her. As a sex-positive person, as someone who has proclivities and interests, as some would say, whoa, that's a little out there for me, but I'm sex-positive. I don't judge others. You don't judge me. As a young ghetto nerd, before the age of the internet, looking at porno magazines, finding dad's porn, dad would leave, go to the video store, your daddy do this, and leave dirty movies out, and you'd watch him before school, and he got on the bus, and make sure you rewound them. But he had to know I was looking, it wasn't an accident, dads do that for their sons, they leave out the dirty magazines. You know, folks who listen to podcasts, I have no guilt about sex, sexuality, I don't understand people who do. Especially if it's coupled with religiosity. I just don't understand it. But we got something interesting going on here. In all of my sexual explorations as a teen, as an elementary school boy, hell, we didn't have the internet, but you found and heard about things. I remember when the internet became hot. Remember that? High school, college? You're a child of the 70s ghetto nerd hip-hop generation? You don't just stumble upon bestiality. I'm sorry to tell you this, ma'am. Your boyfriend didn't just stumble upon bestiality. They're a little pervert. We're looking for images of people having sex with animals because he's on the farm and he's putting his dingus in animals. I understand historically that is how most boys experimented and learned about sexuality, by watching animals, having sex with animals, and engaging in homosexual behavior with each other. Dirty little secret here in America. Them rural farm boys ain't have no women out there. They was doing it with each other. And there's nothing wrong with that. As long as it's consensual, there ain't nothing wrong with it. So don't say Chauncey DeVega is some hypocrite, sex-positive hypocrite who's, I'm not a homo. Get your freak on with each other. Explore. Experiment. But people don't just find bestiality. Let me sit down. Goat, sheep, sex. Come on now. So what we have here is this boy raised in a house with religious fundamentalists who have suppressed and oppressed his human sexuality, because that's another important part of this. Think about that. How religion can damage the mind, especially fundamentalist religion that is anti-sex, anti-discovery about the human body, tells it, these purity balls, looking at girls' hymens. Have you seen this mess? These purity balls, is talk about disturbing. Fathers pledging to defend their daughter's virginity and certifying their hymens are intact? What century is this? What country is this? In Yemen or Saudi Arabia or something? Unbelievable. Rural Algeria. Man, this stuff gets me hot. Not in that way. And I'm not saying, you know, Woody Allen, everything you want to know about sex, you're afraid to ask. Remember that scene? He fall in love with the sheep. But I would tell this woman, number one, your man is lying to you. He was looking for bestiality. He was looking for porn with people having sex with animals. As he confessed to you, he was doing it himself. I'd want to hear the specifics. I'd ask the man, how does it happen? I'm serious. I'm curious. Or, you know, you at the farm, you know, because it smells. It's dirty. It's hay. Horses and animals stink. Yeah, somehow, what's going on in your brain that you're getting aroused? Do you romance the sheep or the goat, whatever you're putting your thing in? Is it a chicken? Does it give you wanting eyes and you pursue it with lust? Was he laying in bed one morning and, as young boys do, he had a nocturnal emission and an erotic dream and he was humping the bed ghost face style and he wandered out into that barn and he said, look at here, Mr. Sheep, it's gonna be you or me and it ain't gonna be me. Oh, hillbilly. So I just want to know how the hell happened. Because young boys and young girls experiment. That's part of normal human sexual development. Not that I have any experience with this, but we real friends at the virtual bar, I know of some young boys, never mind normal masturbation, may have had sex. You know, if you ever heard about this, you take a cantaloupe or a melon. I read about this. I also heard on Loveline. Remember Loveline used to be funny? On AM talk radio and also FM in some markets, late at night on college radio. You could take a cantaloupe or a melon, you cut a hole in it, heat it up in the microwave, and put your dingus in there. Or if you're in jail, I remember reading about this. They say they get magazines in jail, right? Line it with plastic, put lotion in there, and roll it up, and they go to town with the dingus. You got to do what you got to do. Improvising. Never mind boys, you know, experimenting. Not that I've just heard about this. With vacuum cleaners. But at no point in that did said person go and look at animals having sex. So if I was this woman, I say, dear, I say, young lady, ma'am, I ain't know you that well to call you dear. I say, ma'am, he's refusing therapy. He's carrying guilt. He's got religious baggage. He confessed for a reason because he's ashamed. What did he expect your reaction to be? And I would just want to know about what he finds arousing. How did it happen? Would he get an erection looking at animals? Was he bored one day and he said, oh, the bull puts his dingus into the lady cow there? Or, oh, the dogs do it that way. Because animals can't give consent. That's sick, it's cruel, and it's illegal. But I would demand that he get therapy, because I bet you there are some other skeletons, human or animal or other. I guess there's human, animal, I guess there can be another, in this man's closet. And I would be extremely weary of this guy. Not because of the cheap joke about you having a pet and he's going to find him on top of the dog. Or you're going to come home and he's in bed like Woody Allen with a sheep. But I think there's some other things going on there with his sexual development and his identity. And yeah, I know the word normal is ugly. There's a wide range of quote-unquote normal human healthy sexual behavior. but something about this guy is aberrant. When you got somebody confessing they put their dingus in animals, he wasn't six. He wasn't three. This man was a teenager. He knew what he was doing. He knew it felt good. He did it for 3 years. Get away from this sex freak. And that's why I can't have an advice column, because I would tell the truth. But please, lady, run away from this freak. And he ain't a freak in a good way, that's for sure. So another freak, as we do our outro here for the Chauncey DeVega Show, taking it home before we preview next week's great episode on Star Wars, a little more detail. So another freak, grifter, human chaff, professional best black friend for white racists, Ben Carson. I mean, he does look like a zombie. I know comedians have said that. He likes brains, he talks funny, his eyes are weird. And he's a hypocrite, a man who was a product of affirmative action, the social safety net, made and helped by the state in the best sense, lying and trying to destroy the very programs that helped. And again, in the best sense of what a humane society should do, you help sick people, you help kids who don't have glasses, you make sure people can eat, you help people get an education. That's what a just society does. And now he's going to slur it with his lies about Nazis and guns and black people being dumb and stupid and on a plantation. This man is just disreputable, absolutely disreputable. I hear my voice, the contempt I have for him. So I got an email, because I like to get these emails from these right-wing sewer dwellers, because you have to understand the infrastructure that the right wing has built in America. These are grifters. I love reading their letters, their emails, because again, it's an insight into the political operation they've created, how they separate dumb people from their money, and then use those resources to destroy American democracy. So here's a letter, email. Dear American, I like that. It's a cold opening. Can't go wrong with that. Dear American, trying to get the nationalist, patriotic bona fides with that opening. I hate political correctness. It's dangerous. Oh, boy. It's preventing us from speaking honestly about our challenges, our differences, and our culture. Underlined now, because you know if it's underlined, it's important. I'm willing to stand up and fight it, but I need to know if you'll join me. Okay, Uncle Ben. Case in point. I recently said that a key part of Islam known as Sharia law was not compatible with the U.S. Constitution, that I couldn't support a Muslim candidate for president unless these tenets were fully renounced. For example, under Sharia law, women must be subservient and follow, and people following other religions must be killed. The media, the left, whoever that is, and even some fellow Republicans rushed to condemn me. The Council on American Islamic Relations called on me to drop out of the race. How ridiculous. The Judeo-Christian values upon which America was built allowed us to become the greatest force for good on the planet. We shouldn't give them away in the name of political correctness. Everywhere I go, I see more and more people waking up, ready to push back and revive America. We've now accepted over 700,000 grassroots donations. That is a lot of money. Over 4 million people have joined me on Facebook. Our momentum is growing every day, and I need your help now more than ever. I'm not a politician with my finger in the wind. As your president, I will do what I believe is right and just, even if it makes the PC crowd uncomfortable. I will secure the border and enforce our laws. I will call our enemy by its name, radical Islam, and protect the American people. I will institute a flat tax that is simple and fair and close the special interest loopholes. I will protect religious liberty because it's what makes America free. Now, we're going to have to break that sentence down. These hypocrites, craven hypocrites, who think people are stupid. Again, emphasized and bolded. Please join me by donating to my campaign right now. It's always about the money, isn't it? If the next generation is going to have the same opportunities that you and I had, we're going to have to stand up and fight for our values. We can't be afraid of being called names. Oh, God forbid. We know what needs to be done. Please join me. Sincerely, Ben Carson. Well, of course, we got some basic problems here. Number one, America is not founded as a Judeo-Christian society, so that's number one. And these policies they're advocating will actually restrict growth, hurt the economy, and take away people's freedom. You know, that's problem two. And it's interesting they have this conflation, this idea, again, American exceptionalism, just world theory, the idea that America is a dominant force for good in human history. Well, show me the empirics on that. America supports dictatorships. America has waged war all over the world. America it's an empire. As I said, you know, the foreign policy, look at the chaos around the world caused by blowback. But these people are very simple-minded. They're Manichaean, good and bad. Yes, no, black, white, as opposed to realizing the world is about many shades of gray. But just errors in reasoning. I just love this idea about political correctness because conservatives certainly deploy the logic of quote-unquote political correctness and political orthodoxy. Jesus. They're the hallucinatory ideology I wrote about over at salon.com. They are in their own media, their own reality, where empirical reality and empirical facts don't count. Up is down and down is up, because they say so. So that's why you can't even engage in a conversation with these folks, because again, faith is a belief in that which can't be proven by ordinary means. That's what their beliefs about the economy, about politics and history boil down to. And this other thing, I mean, he's getting all this money, separating these rubes from their money with lies. And Sharia law, how the hell is that going to happen in a country where Muslims are a minuscule percentage of the population? Muslims don't even support this thing called Sharia law. I mean, that's a bugaboo cooked up by Fox News. And again, look yourself in the mirror, like Michael Jackson used to say, man in the mirror, oh yeah. See, I can't get an episode without singing. Well, these Christian theocrats have so much in common with Muslim fundamentalists. I said, this is American Taliban, American ISIS in a lot of ways if you gave them the power. They want to have a theocracy based on their very narrow view of the Bible. They think the country is supposed to be a biblical theocracy. Talk about separation of church and state. Ben Carson wants to base the tax plan, the math is just horrendous, on tithing as though it's done in the Bible, 10% of your income. And that's their blind spot. They're talking about Sharia law and Muslims, and they're not realizing they're theocrats themselves. This man believes in, quote-unquote, the devil. This man of science, supposedly. The great deceiver tricked Darwin into thinking about evolution. Yeah, but he's smiling and grinning, ain't he? All the way to the bank. So this is our America. Him and Trump, who are leading 1 and 2 in the Republican polls. They made a monster they cannot control. Exhalation. But as I said, folks, go out there and subscribe to these right-wing newsletters. Just Google newsletters conservative and get on those mailing lists. It is priceless comedy gold, but it is a preview of what's really going on in terms of their strategy, in terms of their mobilizing and how they're trying to game the system to their own advantage. Superficial nationalism, wrapping themselves in the flag as they bring in an authoritarian and theocratic regime and they try to usher it into existence. These are very, 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 very dangerous people, as you know. And people of conscience need to stand up against them. Got to. So, next episode of the Eponymous Union Podcast, known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. As I said, we're going to have Bill Lizard stopping by for the first part of the show where he and I are going to do as we always have been these last year or two. Is that always, or is that better phrased as frequently have done? Where he and I, brothers from another mother, fellow Star Wars travelers along those hyperspace lanes, are going to break down the new trailer, talk about what we think the plot will be now that we have even more information, talk about some of these controversies, and then second half of the show, he and I chatted a few weeks ago. His name is Mark Clark, author of a really cool book. I mean, it is a hell of a Star Wars compendium / encyclopedia. This man has put in work, folks. The book is called Star Wars FAQ, just came out, and basically is part of the FAQ, you know, frequently asked questions series of books. And he takes great questions about the making of Star Wars, the future of Star Wars, toys, merchandising, common misunderstandings, mythologies about Star Wars. Was Lucas, I'll give you one, was he really thinking about Joseph Campbell in the hero's journey? Or is that something he just imputed backwards after talking to Bill Moyers? I don't know. But Mark is a great guest. So it's for Star Wars aficionados, of course. But if you just have a passing curiosity in pop culture, I just think this is going to be a fun conversation for you. Get it from iTunes. Get it from Stitcher. Go to Libsyn. I'm so glad we got our Libsyn site. I want to thank all the folks who subscribe to the podcast every month to cover those operating expenses. But next week, all things Star Wars, I think you're going to like it. And I think I'm going to use the fair use laws and play some of that trailer during the show so Bill the Lizard and I can deconstruct exactly what we're seeing. But as is my standard closer, I keep telling you, I am worried about this food poisoning, man. And it really makes you realize how the elderly and children are vulnerable. This thing can kill you. I don't feel like myself, folks. Send me some positive energy. That's my Cornel West. Isn't it funny how my Cornel West voice sounds like a preacher? Like Pat Robertson or something? He's about to lay hands on the TV and ask for money. Maybe they're all there. That prophetic vision, that prophetic fire. As we always say, this part of the podcast, food poisoned or not, please reach out to someone you have had a falling out with, a dispute, some sort of upsetness with, and just try to make it right. It can be a letter. It can be an email. It can be a phone call. And that way you have the peace of mind of knowing that you tried. You took the moral high road. You were the bigger person. You said, you know what? Hell, man, life is too short. Let's fix this thing. And if they don't respond, at least you know that you tried. It could be they're still mad at you. Maybe they're a petty person. Maybe they're holding on to pain. Maybe they've just moved on in their life and they want to move forward, not back. And they'll have to come around on their own terms in terms of figuring out, hey, you know, I lost something there. That was a good friendship. That was a good relationship. But at least you know that you have tried. And again, as is our standard closer, if you have gold, silver, lucre, extra paper lying about after you listen to the Chauncey DeVega Show, like my work on Salon, Alternet, Indomitable, / We Are Respectable Negroes, / ChaunceyDeVega.com, and you're like, man, you know, let's show this brother some love. I got a little change left over. Go to that PayPal link. Click on it. Send, you know, positive energy is great, but material support is awesome too, because every episode takes a lot of time. I'm not kidding. 4 to 5 hours to do, sometimes more. Between interviewing, editing, and fixing my mistakes, like I had one file, I thought I had not edited it. I had edited it. I had the wrong file to go back and redo the whole thing. I was like, man, I must love you folk. Because I do. I love the conversations. I have gotten so much out of all the wonderful guests like Dr. McAdam, who have sat down here on the podcast. I learn so much every time, and it really is a privilege to have your support as listeners and fans of the podcast and my other work online. It's been going on now for 7 or 8 years. It encouraged me to start the podcast about 2.5, 3 years ago. 1 year now, 1.5 years on a weekly basis. And it's just given me so much intellectually, personally, and emotionally. And it means a lot that I can sit down and every week tell you a story about food poisoning. That's just a once in a lifetime thing. I hope broken legs or near broken legs. Adventures about envelopes on the street. People who are going to beat their kids at McDonald's. Love and romance and have great guests that we feature every week on the podcast. People from academia, creative types, writers, New York Times bestsellers, historians, sociology, English professors, people working in new media. Dang, we got all sorts of cool people. I was looking over them guests. I was like, dang, how'd this happen? How'd this snowball happen? I guess you get one great person, you get another one, you get another one. Because hit the virtual bar, we have great conversations, and I just try to give you guys 100% every time. That's the only promise I can make, is 100% of my effort and my energy. So, as I was saying, we got opportunity costs, time, energy, and resources. So if you can throw some love at that PayPal link, that would be greatly, greatly appreciated. You value what we do, a quarter a show, 10 cents a show, hey, 5 or 10, get a brother a beer. It's greatly appreciated. And please, 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 do take care of yourself. Do take care of your mental well-being. Practice mental and emotional and spiritual self-care. I'm not religious, but I am spiritual. I'm an agnostic / atheist who believes in God. But I'm a spiritual person. We are luminous beings. We are connected, channeling Master Yoda. Take that good and positive energy. Try to do something good for yourself and for those people in your immediate circle of friends. And you know what? I'm going to send a little extra love out for some people. I heard about ESPN in Connecticut. They had some layoffs. A bunch of people, good people, are going to be without work in this perilous economic time. So please put some positive energy towards those people. Those folk need your help too. These are folks who are middle class, upper class folk who thought they had job security and now they don't. So please think about all our Americans who are struggling, who are underemployed, who are working hard. Positive energy to our brothers and sisters trying to make sure that people get a fair wage who work in the fast food industry. We got to stand together, people. We got to support those graduate students and others forming unions, trying to make sure they can have a living wage and not be homeless. Teaching at elite Ivy schools and elsewhere and on food stamps, living in homeless shelters. That's our America, folks. So we got to stand with each other. Please stand with each other. But also, as I say, please take care of our winged, reptilian, bird, fish, and other friends. My spider friend is still here. He or she is like, man, it's cold out. This guy got the heat on, this expensive electricity, and he's letting me hang because I'm pulling weight. I'm doing my work with the gnats. Please take care of our animal friends. Throw some bread out there for the squirrels. Look out for all the animal people. It's going to be cold. Take care of your little animal friend. Give them a hug or a kiss. And if you have home in your life, or if you have space in your home and enough time and energy, please go to the local shelter and adopt a little animal friend. They got dogs. They got cats. They got bearded dragons. I love my bearded dragon people. They've got and they got every single birds, rabbits. Take an animal friend into your life. It'll make your life so much better. You'll love and take care of each other. Please do that for us. Please. So as I always say again, animals, self-care, people, our homeless brothers and sisters, make the world a better place than where you found it. One little step at a time. So until next week, our Star Wars episode with Bill the Lizard and author Mark White, talking about his great book, Star Wars FAQ. Until next week, I want to thank you for listening to, downloading, tweeting, and sharing the eponymously named podcast known as The Chauncey DeVega Show. Please be safe and please be well.